Now that we've described the differences between standard and non-standard delta G values, we can start to put all of this information together into equations to relate the calculation of one to the other. So again, remember that delta G, non-standard, is the actual free energy change at any point in a reaction under non-standard conditions. Again, temperature and pressures and concentrations can change. And so this value will change as a reaction proceeds, as we saw on our video in the graphs. We can use an equation that relates our non-standard delta G to our standard delta G value. And in this equation, we use what I refer to as a correction factor. In this equation, our R value is our gas constant. Because we're working with units of energy and joules, we're going to use our value of 8.314 in units of joules per mole per Kelvin. Our temperature, of course, has to be in Kelvin so that our units of Kelvin for R will cancel out. And then the ln of Q, remember that Q is what we've been using this semester to determine the direction a reaction is going. So Q is set up the same as K, where we have products over reactants, and we raise each of these to an exponent of the coefficients. So the same way that we write a K expression, we're writing Q here. The note that I have off to the side is that for this equation, again, to simplify reporting sig figs, because our last step in this calculation is addition, we're going to use decimal places in delta G naught for our final answer. So however many decimal places you have in your delta G naught value will determine the decimal places to report in your delta G non-standard value. And again, a reminder, because this is a very critical point to understand for this chapter, is that our non-standard delta G value is what changes as a reaction proceeds. This will initially decrease. Again, if you remember from a rough sketch of our video on the graphs, sorry, this is a very horrible graph, starting that over. If we were to sketch a reaction profile, recognize that at time zero, where we're starting just with reactants, our reaction always has to decrease in terms of delta G. And another reminder that with delta G non-standard, we are determining spontaneity for reaction. So when delta G is negative, we say that a reaction is spontaneous at that point. When we say that delta G is positive, or calculate that it's positive, this tells us that at that point in a reaction, it is non-spontaneous. Delta G naught for a given reaction is standard and does not change. It is a constant value. As we saw in a previous video where we calculated this two different ways for a given reaction and got the same value. And again, remember that this is telling us, this quantity is telling us whether a system is product or reactant favored at equilibrium. So again, delta G naught relates to K. Delta G, because it changes as a reaction proceeds, relates to Q. So when we calculate that the delta G naught for a given reaction is negative or less than zero, this tells us our reaction is product favored, again, at equilibrium. And when we calculate that delta G naught is positive, that tells us that our reaction is reactant favored at equilibrium. And again, we can relate these quantities back to K. So for a product favored reaction, we have a large K value greater than one. For a reactant favored system, we have a small K value less than one. To derive our next equation, we take the equation we just looked at and look at what changes in here once our system reaches equilibrium. So remember on our graphs, we defined that at equilibrium, delta G will equal zero. And of course, we know that at equilibrium, the value of Q becomes K. Plugging those two quantities into this equation, we get a setup that looks like this. And I just realized I have a typo in here. That is supposed to be the letter Q. I apologize for that. And so substituting in, our delta G goes to zero and our Q goes to K at equilibrium. To make this equation a little bit easier to see, I'm going to move this quantity to the other side by subtracting it. But then, of course, that's also a little awkward, so I'm just going to flip these two sides around, and we get an equation that allows us to calculate the relationship between our K value at equilibrium and our delta G naught value. And recognizing this equation, very common calculation error is forgetting the negative sign in here. But hopefully you recognize that that negative sign means that we have an inverse relationship. And so the larger a K value, the more product favored a reaction is, the smaller or more negative our delta G naught value will be. And again, sorry for that typo. So again, from our original equation, we have this second equation that now allows us to relate our standard free energy to our equilibrium constant. And again, a note in this one, because everything is multiplication and division, we use sig figs in our values to report sig figs in delta G naught. And realize when we're referring to our equilibrium constant here, this applies to any subscript. So it doesn't matter what system we're referring to, any of the equilibrium constants we've used this semester will apply in this equation. And the last slide that I want to cover in this video is, again, correcting that initial equation to be a Q, sorry again, is to illustrate this table that outlines the relationships between our delta G naught values and K values. We've already discussed these, but this table is a good summary to help you remember. And it's very important to remember these relationships because as you calculate a quantity, it's very helpful to predict what you should get so that once you calculate, you can confirm that your answer makes sense.